It's the beat again.
I've looked at just about every conspiracy out there, you know, because most conspiracy guys do. They have their regular deck of cards, you know, they go through. It's like, And the flat earth side of it was, you know, it was like, it wasn't even like the Joker in the deck. It was like that stupid instructions card that you never, ever look at in a new deck of cards. It's like, that thing. Never looked at it. Not, you know, and sometime during the early part of the summer last year, excuse me, it came, you know, I was looking at it again, and I was like, you know, one of these days, because I'm old enough, I figured I would just address it. I was like, you know what, I'll just stomp this thing out in a weekend, you know, because it's a piece of crap, right? There's nothing to it.
Because your background is software engineering, is it not?
Yeah, big into software, the tech fields, all my life. Started out in gaming, design, you know, helped design games, and that was a lot of fun. So for me, I consider myself a fairly good problem solver. And so when I looked at this, I honestly didn't think much of it, but I watched a couple. The difference was I watched a couple little YouTube videos, one by a German guy, and I couldn't understand a word he was saying, where he was talking about the planes in the Southern Hemisphere. And he goes, look, there's something. He didn't necessarily say flat earth, but he said there's something wrong in the Southern Hemisphere. He goes, the routes are wrong. He goes, there's no way these planes should be taking these weird routes. And that's all of them. He goes, seriously, try to find nonstop flights in the Southern Hemisphere. And I was going, okay, all right. And then I ran into another guy named Matt Boyland, who's, you know, known as a legend in this thing, you know, even though he's only made a couple of videos that I thought were interesting. And he was on camera saying that, look, when he got out of college, he was recruited by NASA to do some photorealistic paintings for different things. And during some party out on the East Coast of the United States, you know, where the power went out, it got down to candlelight and wine, you know, and that usually turns into confession time for most people. And they kind of tried to indoctrinate him into this, where they said, look, you know, they drew the whole thing out and they said, look, it's flat. And he thought, he absolutely didn't buy it, you know. He was 25 when they told him that. And, you know, if I was 25, I don't know what would have happened to me. So I go, okay, fine. I get that. It's a good story. Don't know if I'm buying it. So I start digging into it, you know, start churning through some topics, and looked at Admiral Byrd from the Hollow Earth, looked at the Southern Hemisphere flights, and then looked at a lot of stuff that kept pointing back to NASA, you know, the United States. I forgot, where are you, by the way?
I'm in mainland Europe.
Oh, cool. And so everything kept pointing back to NASA. And I looked, I was going, well, this should be easy enough. You know, all I have to do is find some pictures of the Earth from space. And then it started clicking, because I remembered something from years ago when I was in this office. I was running this tech support team, and I wanted to put a picture of the Earth from space in all these monitors. And, you know, I'm Googling stuff. And this was back in 2000, 2001. And I'm Googling, you know, Earth from space. And nothing was coming up. It was like one image, not like nowadays where you get, you know, a whole bunch of composites. Literally, it was just rows and rows and rows of exactly the same image in different resolutions. I was going, and it was right in front of my face, and it didn't even occur to me. And I was going, NASA, you suck. How could you be this far behind? You know, it didn't make any sense. So flash forward to last year, you know, or early this year, when, you know, 2014, 2015, I still couldn't find any that were legit. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of Google Earth snapshots and lots of composites and stuff. And the more I dug into it, the worse it got, to the point where, remember, I'm trying to debunk this, right? I'm trying to put, I love globes. I've got a wonderful picture of a drawing of a globe thing over on my wall. And every time I look at it, I'm keeping it now as kind of like a posterity thing. Because every time I looked at it, I kept pulling on more and more threads to where I was trying to prove the globe, and I was failing. I was failing badly. And I got it. I so understood the whole indoctrination thing. I got the message, and that was, I had the same reaction that most people did, maybe even you, and that is when someone comes to you and say, how do you know you're on a globe? And your first reaction, everybody's first reaction is the same, which is weird. They say, well, we know. Duh. It's obvious we're on a globe. Why would you ever think otherwise? I go, okay, how do you really know? How do you really know? In fact, tell me how you know without using the word NASA. And then there's a series of reactions that come from them, because a lot of people, you know, you can talk about conspiracies with people all day long, and if it doesn't affect them directly, they won't, you know, it'll be like, oh yeah, 9/11, ah, the financial system, ah, it's Sandy Hook. You know, it doesn't affect me, right? But when you start messing with their world, there are some people that react very strongly and against it, and I totally understand. I mean, every interview I've done where people are in chat rooms on the side, and I don't see them. In fact, I make sure I don't see them. You can see the host just going, "Holy smokes!" Because people get really angry. They do that whole Neo thing when Morpheus first shows him, by the way, here's what the Matrix really is, and Neo freaks out. That's what people do. It's like, don't mess with my world.
So Mark, I've got a question for you, right? You remember the guy who jumped from the
Red Bull?
Yeah.
Oh, I know where you're going with this.
Well, yeah, I swear the pictures, if I went back over those pictures, it would seem that we live on an oval planet. Okay, I'll throw that out there.
Yep. That people have shown me the Red Bull thing, and that got media attention. Don't think that's by accident. Okay, you'll see it. And basically what it shows is a side-by-side comparison with a generic group. I think the group was called Dog Cam, which was a weird name, and no more weirder than Red Bull, I suppose. And they were at 110,000 feet. The Red Bull thing was 120,000 feet. Dog Cam shows no curve whatsoever. Red Bull shows an extreme curve on all sides. It's a fisheye lens, and it's the old trick. It's an old trick, and they do that. NASA uses it all the time. And when I saw Red Bull, as soon as I saw that, that got national news attention, because, you know, it was a big story for a couple of days. It was like, oh, look at this. That's when people started bouncing this off, and it's very apparent to me. There's lots of people sending up weather balloons. Some private, some corporate endorsed. And depending on which one you look at, you're either seeing a curve or you're not seeing the curve. But how is that possible? It isn't possible. You know, it can only be one or the other. And I'm always going to go with the flat one.
Okay. So why?
why on which level?
Why
would they hide it?
Yeah, why would we be? What on earth is going on if we're living on a flat Earth? Clearly, there's quite a lot of hidden conspiracy going on, from politics to the financial systems to religion. Everything on this planet is pretty backwards. There's no doubt about that. But why on earth would they try and convince us that we live on a round planet? And we don't.
There's a couple reasons for it. And I have no doubt in my mind, the deeper I dug, I have no doubt that, and take your pick on which secret society, I'm not going to name them, but I like to lump them up into one big thing called the authority. And that is, I believe the authority at the highest level had the maps hundreds of years ago, but technologically, they could never prove it. You know, and if you watched any of the clues, you know, hot air balloons, you know, weren't even invented until 1760, the first planes, not until 1900. So basically, they had to wait until the internal combustion engine was invented before they could even start looking for it. Because, because you're never going to go high enough. And Antarctica, what we call Antarctica, was so hostile, you were never going to cross any great lengths of it without an internal combustion engine. So once that engine was completed, they send their best guy, Admiral Byrd, an American explorer, probably the best explorer in the world at the time. He does the North Pole in 1926 in a plane. And then for whatever reason, they turn him around and they send him to Antarctica in 1928. And they keep sending him for basically the rest of his life. From 1928 until 1950, 30 years, he just kept going down there and hammering this thing. Couldn't find it. And at one point, I almost believe that the authority thought that it wasn't there. Because in 1954, again, if you watch any of the clues, I put it in clue two called The Bird Wall. There's a great little, thank God we have this footage, when he did an interview in 1954 on CBS over here. And where he comes on television and says, oh, yeah, Antarctica is just made out of money. All the countries are lined up, you know, down there to get it. You know, England, Russia, Chile, Australia, New Zealand, they're all ready to do this. You know, there's oil, there's minerals, there's coal, there's uranium. There's no plant life to worry about. There's no animal life to worry about. It's just this, it's going to be, you know, in fact, he was even questioning during the interview if we would start fighting over this place because it's, you know, so resource rich. And then something happens. And for me, there was no doubt that they found it. They found the edge or the marker or the barrier or whatever you want to call it, because at that point, everyone freaks out. And they seal off Antarctica. You know, everyone got off the ice at the same time. And within a very short amount of time, all the nations of the world that were down there unilaterally agree to seal off Antarctica forever. No corporation to date. And again, you know this, if you follow the financial systems, we're based on greed and power and money. And there are certain corporations in this world that have the backstage pass to go anywhere. You know, if they want to get into, if the petroleum company wants to get in your backyard, they're going to get in. But they can't even talk about going to Antarctica. No corporation on any country in the world is allowed to go there and do business. No mineral company, no oil company, no gas company, nobody. And that for me, you know, went so far against, if it had been done on its own, that's one thing. But to have your greatest explorer come on television and say, circle the wagons, let's get everybody ready to make money, and then they turn around and do the exact opposite. I've never seen anything like that in my life. You know, and then follow that with the space program, which was a joke since day one. But then I realized why the space program. You know, NASA was formed in 1958. And I know I'm rambling, but the Van Allen radiation belts, announced by NASA in 1959, basically saying nobody wants to go up very high because it's super radioactive and dangerous. The very same year they announced that was the same year they shut off Antarctica. There's an old saying, and that is, I believe in coincidences, I've just never seen one. You know, that one was just way too, it just screamed structure to me. At that point, I just kept building and building to where now I'm going straight at NASA. Every interview I do, not necessarily this one, but every interview I do from this point out, I'm going straight at them, going, look, prove me wrong, because everything you've shown me, it basically says that you've been faking this since the beginning, and you know, come clean while you can, because the internet is seems to be ramping up for this. I don't know why. You know what?
But how would a flat Earth work in principle? And what does that mean about the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets, the universe?
Okay. In principle, as a mechanics, and again, I touch on this in clue 5 and 6 and part of 7, but the Reader's Digest version is this. If anyone has seen, and I know the movie's a little older now, if you have seen The Truman Show, which was only supposed to be, you know, The Truman Show was based on a dome structure that was about 20 miles wide where he was born into it. If you increase the size of that to thousands of miles wide, and potentially instead of a few miles high, hundreds of miles high, technically you could do just about anything inside it. You could control, you know, massive amounts of artificial weather, using the underwater conveyor system for the oceans. You could do just about anything you wanted as far as, you know, the what's on the ground. As far as the sky's concerned, and I don't know if they have planetariums out where you are out there, but planetarium is a perfect example. I know nobody goes to those things anymore, but imagine the sky being a giant planetarium for the most part. So the stars and the planets, I have no doubt they are a beautifully rendered image, as stuff that we've been doing in the gaming world, you know, really well since about 2004. But the sun and the moon appear to be, and I'm saying appear to be, you know, if someone proves me wrong, hey, great, I'm willing to accept that. The sun and the moon to be, I believe, are three-dimensional objects that are much, much smaller. The sun is not 92 million miles away. The moon is not 237,000 miles away. And if you want evidence of that, you know, people, the sun is a little tough because it's super, super bright, and it's tough for anyone to get a good bead on it. But you want to put doubts in people's minds about the moon, have them go to the YouTube channel Crow777, if you've ever heard of that. It's brilliant. The first time I ever saw that, and coming from the gaming world, I knew exactly what I was looking at. As soon as I looked at it, I was going, because I've seen this in games and simulations all day long. It's like, why is there a refresh issue in the moon? And then it started clicking. I'm just going, wait, there's a refresh issue with the moon. And I absolutely believe his videos. I know some people come at him and say, oh, no, he had to have faked it. And, you know, he's got motivation.
Hang on. Mark, you're saying there's a refresh issue. What does that mean?
Oh, a resolution issue. Okay, so everyone remembers back in the day when if you made a motion picture and you were filming a television set, when you played it back, it looked like the television sets had this weird vertical flicker that was going through them. And that's because the frame rate, frames per second on the movie camera is different from the frames per second on the television. They don't sync up, but you don't see that when you're filming it. But when it plays it back, the camera has to compensate for it. And so all you get is this weird refresh rate. It's really weird. You don't see it in real life, but you see it on the playback. That is what I was looking at. In fact, I just talked to Crow recently about this. That is what I was looking at. It appears that our camera technology, there's some technologies that haven't really improved over the years, the combustion engine, but our camera technology, especially HD camera technology, seems to have caught up almost with whatever this place is, because it was a very slow but very steady refresh, resolution refresh, frames per second issue difference between the camera that was filming it and whatever it was projecting on the moon. And and people will say, well, okay, is it being projected on from an outside source or is it being projected on from the inside? I don't really care. All I know is that I absolutely believe that what we see is the moon, you know, that the fun stuff, the craters and the gray and all that nice detail. I'm saying that there's something else underneath that appears to be the real moon, and whatever's on the outside of it is just an image.
Because Crow talks about and has shown on his videos a kind of tidal wave that goes over the moon.
Yeah, if from a display standpoint, and again, that's why I believe it's a three-dimensional image, because if it was just a 2D, you know, some people said, well, you know, it's flat and it's projecting on two sides, but you wouldn't get those weird waves seemed to be circling, not just up, but kind of circling around. He had a great eye to catch that. And we were so lucky. I mean, I was talking to him about it, and he was saying that he goes, I was like 2 seconds away from deleting the whole thing because I thought my camera was broken. You know, it was a brand new camera. And, you know, once he put it out there, talk about fate, you know, once he puts it out there, you know, lots of other people were confirming the same thing. Not as good as him, but it is out there. And it was completely obvious to me. But the point was this. And even though I've gotten into some trouble because people said, well, you know, he's not a true flat earther, blah, blah, blah. Maybe not. But it doesn't matter to me because it fits into the model I use, because you have to cast doubt on the moon first and NASA and the space program. Once you do that, once you break down that, the rest of everything starts to crumble. Because
Okay, so just come back a little bit. So yeah. Casting doubt on the moon, just from my experience, I'm on the Mediterranean and I get the moon rising to, never reached a wheat, sorry, the east, and sure. It goes over to the west, okay, right?
Yeah.
And I've always thought to myself, the moon's quite a strange entity. And I thought, what is that? What is it?
Oh, yeah.
And I've said to people, what is that? They said it's the moon. So what is it about the moon? And then the next question is, what is it about NASA? Because clearly NASA are telling us they've gone to the moon, the Apollo missions, blah, blah, blah. And there's this whole thing about the fact that, I don't know, who was it? The Red Hot Chili Peppers in one of their songs were saying, the space is great in basement in Hollywood or whatever, and so on and so forth. So just give me some background.
Yeah, sure. The moon, by the way, is an enigma in itself. People, there's so many interesting little things about the moon, but the one that bugs me more than anything, and nobody, people say, well, it's a coincidence, and that is that the rotation it is perfectly synced up with us. We always see from this side the exact same part of the moon. People going, well, that's just the way it is. I'm going, no, you don't understand the probability that you're saying that it doesn't even rotate a fraction of a degree an hour, or even anything. So like 10 years could go by, 100 years, and you're still seeing the exact same face of the moon. That sort of sync up is so unlikely, and people just gloss right over it, and that drives me insane. But to your point, and that was, if there's a refresh issue with the moon, if there is doubts with the moon, and there really, really is, then what did NASA land on? They didn't land on anything. And that was a question, and it was such a great revelation for me, because it was something that was bugging me for years. Because one of the oldest arguments about the Apollo program, and people have been arguing about the Apollo program for decades, right? Ever since it happened. And it's just gotten louder and louder as the internet has gone on. But what they've said, the big argument is, well, why would they fake it? Why would they bother faking it? And that's coming from the other side, saying, why would they have to fake it? They're not gaining anything. And that bugged me, because I was going, they got a point there. Why would you fake it? Why does it make any difference? But once I got into this whole enclosed world thing, then the whole tone changed, because it morphed it from a question to really a statement, which was, it's not that they wanted to fake it. They had to fake it. If you do not fake the moon landing, if you do not fake the space program, you are going to run into problems in the long term. One of the biggest would be corporations, because and actually, Matt Boylan said it the best, which was, look, you're hitting the 1960s. We have no picture of the Earth. How long can you keep that going? Sooner or later, you've got to get a picture of the Earth. We had the rocket program, since 1957, and there are no pictures. You go all the way until 1972 before you actually release a picture. Unfortunately, this is how things work. We're a curious bunch, humans, and you can't just hand people pictures of the Earth. You that's what they would love to do. It's like, oh yeah, by the way, this is what the Earth looks like. But no, because people go, oh, how'd you take it? You had to create a space program, a fake space program, just to simulate the technology of getting a picture that high up. And when they did that, unfortunately, they got caught. It just snowballed after that, because you had to keep faking it after that. And everyone knows. I mean, the other old questions. Again, I'm going to bash on NASA here. It's like, look, why aren't there any moon bases? Why did no other country go up to the moon and kick over our the United States flag? Why did that not even bother? Or I'll throw one for you, and I've been bringing this up recently. Russia's got a program, supposedly. China, Japan had JAXA. Look into that, JAXA. What happened there? No one's talking about that. Why did the UK conspicuously completely abandon any space program whatsoever? I know damn well why. That's because there's like, they're fake. They knew full well who was faking it, and they just was like, we're not going to spend money on this. We're not even going to bother. You guys can do whatever you want. We're not going to be a part of it. And actually, if this ever comes true, they're going to look like saints by comparison, because they were like, they can just claim, they can claim innocence, but truth was they knew since day one. So breaking down the moon, once you break down the moon, you break down NASA. Once you break down NASA, again, who are the gatekeepers of this whole thing? Then the rest of it falls apart.
Okay, but that's still that's still
okay. Well, okay, I know what I probably lost the question. Where
I can't remember either. we're both slightly lost in it. But that doesn't explain how we are living on a flat piece of something.
Okay.
In the middle of what?
Oh, okay. No. That's good, because people ask that all the time. What is, if we are in a giant 1,000-mile, 2,000-mile wide Truman Show, what's outside of this place? It depends on who you ask. If you don't like being fenced in, because some people don't like the whole, you know, being enclosed thing, which I do, then we're on a much, much bigger plane with more, I'll just use this as an example, more circles like this on the ground, you know, more puddles, more ponds of us. Do we have access to them? I doubt it. There's some people, you know, that want to be more optimistic and say, oh yeah, we have access to, you know, we can go to other worlds, and the other worlds are actually just, you know, more dome, you know, more structures like this. And I say, you know what? I wouldn't think that anyone that was smart enough to build something like this wouldn't let a race like us just run amok, you know, just start roaming around, because we do the same thing that we're doing here, we do in other places. You know, don't think that we, you know, build a utopia just out of thin air. Could it be, you know, there's other people that have suggested that it's literally a biblical translation, that the structure is actually a firmament that separates the waters above from the waters below, and that the flood, the ancient floods of old, were actually just, you know, just popping something at the top of this thing and letting the water come in. Because, you know, if you let it rain for 40 days, you're really not going to raise sea levels that much, even, you know, even if you had it going all over the place. There's other people. I'm a big believer that it's that outside of this is really just a bigger room with a bigger dimension. I'm not going to name it heaven, but you know, that it's a more unlimited dimension on top of this one. And then yet more people have said, well, couldn't there be space outside of this? And I said, yeah, there can, but why? And that is, if you build small, you simulate big, meaning, as long as you can fake space, why would you have real space outside of it? You know, a planetarium, that's the whole goal, is to fake space. If we're on a Truman Show, roughly, you know, I'm not going to go into the reality TV side of it, but if we're on a Truman Show and you're faking, the stars and the planets, then you don't need to actually have real space out, you know. Honestly, we could be a snow globe on somebody's desk. But I have no doubt, and again, I know there's lots of people, you know, whoever's listening to this, you know, their initial reaction is going to be, oh no, it's crazy. I'm going, look, I thought it was crazy. 9 months, I beat on this thing to the point where it's like, fine, it may not be perfectly flat, it may not even be enclosed, but I know it's not a globe anymore. I know that. So whatever's, and I've got a pretty creative mind. So if NASA's hiding something other than this, I'd love to know what it is, because I haven't been able to get my head around it yet.
So how come you're so convinced that we're not on a globe?
The two big ones, if I had to pick two out of the clues that I've done, and I've done 11 clues and an intro, which is a big basic overview, the two clues would be this. The first one is, and again, I'm putting this back on the space agencies, not just NASA, but the others, and that is, it's 2015 as we're talking.
Apparently,
yeah, exactly. All right, by our calendar, it's 2015. Yeah. Why, with all our technological advances and the internet seems to be running at full speed, and there's lots of access to stuff out there, why are there no pictures of the Earth from space? That would be probably the number one. Because we have the ability to do this. And there's lots of different side aspects to this, but it still boils down to that. It's like, look, and there's a guy on there, I can't remember his name, but he made this great video where he went on this just tear, where he was going in real time through Google, just ripping on it. And I know the language is a little rough, but it was still great.
When you say ripping on it, what do you mean?
Basically, he was going through every, he was just going through the images row by row and saying, look, composite, admitted composite. It's it and people are lazy. Graphical artists, you know, they tend to, everyone tends to steal from each other. So everyone kept stealing the same two or three images and just making little tweaks to them and then putting it back up. And he's going, look, there's the same cloud formation. Look, the same cloud formation. Look, here's Apollo 17. There's really only two images that are being used right now. One is the Apollo 17 image. That's 40 years old. There's no updates to that. And the other one, which happens to be, coincidentally, if I'm not mistaken, the original globe image that was put on the first iPhone, if you remember the default globe image on the iPhone, that guy, you can find that on YouTube. He actually went did an interview, and it was just a little side thing. He was, oh, yeah, I had to make that because I couldn't find any images of the Earth.
Wow.
And he's like, oh, I'm looking at this, but the guy that went on this rant, he's absolutely spot on, and it doesn't make any sense. I can't overstate this enough. It's, look, there should be tens of thousands of images. There should be forget about images. Try to find video. Some of the video, and that was torn apart almost instantly, where they did like a 24-hour time lapse thing, but the weather didn't morph. The clouds didn't morph. It's like, wait, so it's not a true time lapse. It's just a bunch of simulated images you put together, and you were too lazy to figure out how to do the weather patterns. There should be real-time television stations dedicated with geosynchronous orbit dedicated to this. That's my number one thing, because it points at one group, which is NASA, and that's 1958. When they were created, I have no doubt that they're the gatekeepers at the highest level. Most people working at NASA have no idea. At the highest level, though, I think they know. Two, of course, the other one, because that's the upper part. The outer part is Antarctica, and that to me goes against. Again, it's not a technological thing, it's a human nature thing. And that is, you cannot tell me, after all we have witnessed over the last 20, 30 years, that a corporation, no matter how much they bribe, no matter how many palms they grease, cannot get in there. And not only can they not get in there, they aren't even allowed to discuss it. It's not like, you know, we read news stories like, you know, British Petroleum trying to get in Antarctica, you know, coming up against adversity, you know, because those stories would come out because they would pay the papers to spin the story their way. No one's even, that treaty isn't even, it is ironclad. No treaty, it isn't even up for discussion until 2041. How does that happen? And now it's even protected by a secondary one, which was, oh, they said, well, it's environmental now. Yeah, going, yeah, fine. You can pull out the environmental card now. But when this treaty was put in place, it was 1959. Greenpeace, the granddaddy of all environmental groups, they weren't even created until 1971. Nothing existed in 1959. They just locked it down, shut everybody out, and just kept the story. In fact, hadn't it been for the Admiral Byrd interview in 1954, which is on YouTube, people can look it up, I don't think it'd get nearly as much traction as it did. I was just so fortunate to find that. I don't even remember where I found it. I think it was just some guy just posted it, but he got it from a CBS affiliate. So between those two things, for me, that you got your upper edge, you got your outer edge. And they were both basically sealed off at the same time. I'll throw in one more, and that is the high altitude atomic weapons testing that started in 1958 by the United States and the Russians for no apparent reason. They fired nukes straight up for 4 years, big ones, and both sides, no apparent reason, just keep firing them up. One of the packages was called Operation Fishbowl. Why was it called Operation Fishbowl? I have no idea. And then they both gave up on the exact same day in 1962. And then that was it for the aerial testing. And again, putting myself in their shoes, that's exactly what you would do. You'd hit it, and then excuse me. And then after you couldn't do it, you just start probing the edges and trying to figure out how high you could send rockets without crashing them.
Right. Whoa, so you are suggesting that they were firing nukes up to see if they could break through the dome?
Yeah. Okay. The first, in fact, if you look at the shots, and this is, well, relatively public record as far as we know.
When did this start?
1958.
And finish?
1962. And you could look it up. All you have to do is look up Google or Yahoo or whatever you use, high altitude nuclear testing. And the first couple shots were small, tiny. Again, it's what I would do, you know, a couple kiloton. And then the second and third shots were just approaching like 4 megaton, which is monstrous for 1958. And again, coincidences. So you take a couple, you paint the target with a couple shots, you hit it as hard as you can. And then almost immediately after that second shot, NASA was formed. It was like, okay, well, we're not getting through this thing, so we're going to have to militarize space, which they did. And then every other shot after that was much, much less. The yield was much, you know, they were talking maybe 100 kilotons to a couple hundred kilotons, much, much smaller. And for me, it's exactly what you would do. You would just start probing. It's like, okay, where? Because they have to draw this thing out. It's like, okay, where are we doing this? Because when they send up rockets at that point, they need to know when to bend them over. And again, watch that footage if you ever want to know. It's like, why don't rockets go straight up? Why do they make that horribly curving arc? It's like, look, escape velocity is escape velocity. Why not just send them up at the highest freaking angle you can? And they don't.
So you're suggesting that the powers that be that are in control of the militaries, they're not part of the group that's created the dome. They're in the dome with us.
They are there in the dome with us. They found out. I think it was supposed to be. Of course, you know, whoever created it. But I think it was supposed to be part of the natural process. And I talked about this in one of the clues because people say, why would you hide it from the people? And it's like, well, you have to hide it from people. And I did the whole wildlife preserve thing, and that makes us seem kind of lower life formish. But if you don't hide the fence. If you don't immediately hide the fence, sooner or later, people are really curious and they don't like being fenced in. They will dedicate their lives and they will be consumed with the fence or the barrier or the wall or whatever it is. But I think eventually it was supposed to be a natural process where we were supposed to find out. However, the first people that found out, no accident there, was the governments, more specifically United States and Russia, who never been enemies. They were in on it since, you know, with They joined forces almost immediately afterwards, and they've tried to keep it. And people say, okay, why would you keep it a secret, right? That's also a big question. And that is, okay, think of it this way. If you don't keep it a secret, there is a real possibility. Yeah, society would immediately change. There would be this huge fundamental shift. And I'm not going to pick on religion. I touched on the clues. But you're basically giving all of the big five religions of the world, their holy grail. You're basically saying, oh yeah, by the way, there's some proof of intelligent design over there, probably a handprint of God type of thing. Doesn't matter who built it. You could tell them all you want. It's like you could tell them it's aliens, but the religions of the world will immediately look at that and say it's divine. And once they do that, science is going to be backpedaling for a while, maybe 10, 20, 30 years, where religion's going to come back and it's like, we told you that there's intelligent design. And honestly, from an authority standpoint, that's a big mess. It's a soup sandwich that you don't want to deal with. So all you do at that point is you just say, you know what? And that meeting would have been easy. They would have sat down. It's like, you know what? Let's just hold on to this thing as long as we can. And then they had to figure out, okay, what do we need to do to keep this secret? And it's like, well, Antarctica is not that hard because nobody wants to go down there anyway, except for the corporations. And it's like, okay, we'll just, you know, put it under a treaty, say it's a national security issue. And now how they got all the other countries to sign on to it, that's a whole nother thing. And then all you have to do is protect space. And since none of us own spaceships, that's pretty easy. And it worked all the way up until recently because, you know, we had a couple private space corporations, SpaceX and Virgin Galactic. And SpaceX, you know, and they were, you know, delays and mistakes and malfunctions and all this fun stuff. And then finally SpaceX miraculously, oh yeah, by the way, we just did this. It's like, oh, okay. So you finally, you know, let them in on it because they weren't going to quit. And so
are you suggesting that Antarctica is a ring around us? It's the outer edge of
as ridiculous as it sounds.
It does.
And it sounds nutty.
It does sound absolutely bonkers, that's right.
It's the only thing that it could be at that point, because you have to stretch on a flat map. And again, the if you saw the clues, you know, it's called the azimuthal equidistant map. Antarctica, and this is a map used by the USGS currently. It's in their catalog. The coast of Antarctica is stretched around the entire outside. Now, I know some people throw in the layman's term and they say it's a it's an ice wall and it's all that, but you gotta remember, Antarctica is a really unique continent from that standpoint. From negative reinforcement standpoint, it's brilliant. It slopes up a couple hundred feet at the shoreline, almost ice all the way around. Well, whatever you see is ice. And then it's steep from that point up. It goes up to 10,000 feet and plateaus at 10,000 feet and, you know, to where you've got altitude sickness. And then it keeps going up from there, you know, 13,000, 20,000. It's really a hostile place. And there's no plant life and no animal life. Talk about it is the least desirable place to explore you could ever create, you know, because there's no resources to reinforce your thing. Whatever you take with you, that's what you have. And it's from that standpoint, it's a great negative reinforcement, because if anyone tries to go there, that's the best part of it, is whenever you turn back, you think it's your decision. You know, it's like, we ran out of food, ran out of water, it's too cold, it's too miserable. But the truth is, those reinforcements were there, you know, put in place for you. You know, all the icebergs, the horrible weather down there, it's a great design. And that's from a design standpoint, as the more I looked into it, not only could I not improve on it, I was just stunned by this, just the little things of this structure, you know, whether it's a globe or an enclosed system. The little design features were great. Like I'll throw one more, and I know I'm rambling, but like the 3% salt solution added to the oceans. People understand that slows down because that makes it, humans can't drink it at that point. But marine life, you know, pretty adaptable. At that point, it slows down ocean exploration by 95% because you can't drink what you're sailing on. It's great, great stuff. So anyway, sorry, that's my rant.
Okay, so if the moon is a hologram of sorts,
yeah,
and the sun is a very hot hologram of sorts, because
yes,
you know, when I lie in the sun, I generally get brown. Then are we suggesting that the stars and the rest of the planets are also holograms, and that the likes of Stephen Hawking, as an example, famous scientists from the UK,
yeah,
we're suggesting that all his theories are absolutely balderdash.
Not deliberately, you know. I'll throw Albert Einstein in there, who was what was he, Swiss initially and then German, but he was also Jewish.
He's also whatever. A Freemason, though.
Well, yeah. You got to remember that there are a lot of scientists out there that base their work, like anything, they base their work on other people's work, on other people's work. But the origin, the foundation of the original person's work is where this whole thing started. So again, I'm not knocking Stephen Hawking, brilliant guy and everything, but he's basing his work on the original assumption of the solar system and time space and everything else that, you know, once you start down that wrong path, no one's going to deviate from it, because why would you ever deviate from it? You know, you make, again, it's not necessarily assumptions. They are the groundwork of your work. And so, yes, I do believe he's wrong, but I believe they're all wrong. But I don't think it's a giant conspiracy. Some people say, well, no, they were all in it. No, of course they weren't all in it. You know, that's, grab any grad student out of any university that studied astrophysics or astronomy. And, you know, they're going to say, well, everything is based off textbooks, which have been revised, revised, revised for hundreds of years. The globe model has been in place since the mid-1500s. That's 20 generations. I'm not knocking the doctrine. It has worked extremely well. And for the common man, me included, like, look, all you have to do is put a globe in your classroom when you're 6 years old. You don't even have to talk about it. And that's it. Once you get out of school, you know, assuming you don't go to, you know, to do postgrad work and anything like that, it's already there. It's already in your head. But yes, every scientist that has gone down this path, unfortunately, they are mistaken, but not because of any error in their motivation or their theories, just that they're basing their work on bad science to begin with.
And I know that one of your theories is also based on the flight patterns, isn't it, of aeroplanes?
Yes.
And I just wonder whether you could tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, you bet.
I touched upon it earlier, but I know there's quite a lot of information on that front.
Clue seven, I started on that one, and I probably should have touched on it earlier, but what I did was I looked, it was an expansion on the German guy who said that everything in the southern hemisphere is all connections, which makes no sense because, you know, everything in the northern hemisphere where you and I are, you can get connections, especially over here. You can get connections all day long. It's just a question of how much money you want. I'm sorry. You can get nonstops all you want without, it's just how much money you want to pay and what time you want to leave. That's not a big thing. But in the southern hemisphere, it is really, really tough to get nonstops. Especially between anywhere in South America and anywhere in Australia. And I thought that was really odd because there are, you know, and there's some cities you can't, absolutely. But so I was saying, look, it doesn't matter how much money you pay, there's 95% of the flights in the Southern Hemisphere are connections, and they're horrible connections. They're sending you from Buenos Aires to Dubai and then back down. Or my favorite one was like Rio to Sydney, Australia. It was going through Los Angeles. And I was like, why in the world would you ever go to why would you go to the United States and then go back down, right? Or San Francisco. But when you turn the map, so on a globe, it made this weird triangle, you know, up and down. But when you put it on the AE map, on the flat map, it's a straight shot, literally. And again, the odds of that happening, you know, and if it wasn't a straight shot, it was just a shallow dog leg, right? And
is there a map online that will show me that?
Oh yeah. There's videos. In fact, I've got a short playlist on my channel. One video is called "Flat Earth." I think the plane proves the plane. Or the planes prove the plane, and the other one's called Plane Routes Exposed. But both of them will show pretty much the same thing, and there's lots of people doing it. I mean, I put it out there. Again, I'm not going to take credit for the original idea, but it's all very, very true. What was interesting, though, was as soon as I said, look, you can't, there's some cities you can't get nonstops. It doesn't matter how much money you pay, doesn't matter how, and some of these flights are taking, if they're not weird little angles, they're taking forever because, like, if you go from like Rio to, sorry, I gotta turn that off. If you go from like Rio to somewhere in Australia, it should be just, or Australia to South America, it should be just a straight shot. It's just the South Pacific Ocean. Nobody's airspace you have to mess with. 12 hours, gone, right? Some of these flights, some of these connections were pushing 30, 40. I even saw some in the low 50s as far as hours go. When does that happen? Two pushing 3 days to get somewhere? It should take 12 hours? No. But as soon as I made that video, I was working on video 8, and then I had people emailing me saying, oh, I found nonstops. And they kept mentioning, there's only like 5 of them, right? And they kept mentioning them to me. It's like, so... It drove me insane. It's like, so the 95% of connections, you know, that doesn't bother you. But but immediately say, well, I found a nonstop, therefore flat earth must be completely false, right? And they kept mentioning this Auckland, New Zealand to Santiago, Chile flight. And so I go, okay,
here's what I'll do.
I will figure this out. I will do another video and I will figure out just to shut those people up. And I made clue 9, which was called the magic show. And boy, did I luck out on that one, because luckily for us, again, technology is a double-edged sword. I found some real-time tracking, stuff. Planefinder.net was my favorite. And I was watching, I'm staring at the screen, watching, because you can watch in real time these planes. And I'm watching these planes, I'm watching everything below the equator, and there's no planes in the oceans in the southern hemisphere. I was going, all right. So I'm doing stuff. I check every 30 minutes. I pull up the page, refresh it, make sure it's nothing's getting weird. I just close it, reopen, close and reopen. And I do this for 4 days, 5 days. I slept. And it all of a sudden, because I'm dense sometimes, I was going, wait a minute. Forget about the nonstops. What happened to the connecting flights? Why is there nothing going over these oceans? And so I start staring at some of these flights that are leaving. And when they got about 150, 200 miles offshore, they'd blink out. I was going, anyway, just disappeared in front of my face. I was going, huh, what's that all about? So, and it happened again and again and again to the point where I was going, okay, what am I looking at exactly? So, and then I'd try to find the flights, just on their data track. And the flights, not only was it disappearing on my screen, but their individual logs, they were disappearing. So instead of saying, here's your latitude and longitude, they were saying they were going into a mode called estimated or approximated. And basically, they weren't telling you where these planes were at all. And they would stay that way for hours and hours and hours until like an hour before touchdown, blink, they'd pop back on. And then I got it. I was going, again, because I love problem solving. I was going, yeah. That's very, very clever, because that's what I would have done. It's like if you want to make sure that nobody looks at the logs or anything, it's just a huge broad stroke. You disappear everything in the Southern Hemisphere. And some of the other trackers, they would try to simulate, a plane going across, but the individual logs would still show approximated or estimated, which meant they weren't there. And you would have to do that because you don't want to show people how the planes are getting there. So people are saying, these flights can't be real. I'm just going, well, they may be real, but it doesn't matter because the routes can't be proven. So if I want to go from, somewhere in South America, somewhere in Australia, yeah, you can. That's why nobody's picked up on this until now. Yeah, you take off from there and you land over there. Everybody's happy. The pilots are happy. The passengers are happy. Nobody cares. You can't prove, though, how you got there. The route is what's different. The route is what's hidden. And they do that because in some cases they have to take routes, because remember, it's all autopilot now. They just plug everything and let them go. And people kept coming back and saying, the pilots have to know. The pilots have to know. I'm going, no, they don't. And here's the reason why. It's because if you're a pilot, you have to make, forget about the fact that it's not gonna kick in. So even if you don't know, because everybody, when you look over out the window, it's like, where are we over anyway? That even if the fuel consumption is wrong, even if they can't explain what's sitting outside their window, even if all this stuff happens, the last thing you are ever gonna think is that the map is wrong. They are never gonna, it's such a massive leap of faith to say that the map is wrong. And even if you do say the map is wrong, what are you gonna say? How wrong is it? And then if you make it that far, then what do? Do you go to the FAA? Do you go to the airline and say, hey, by the way, I think the map's wrong? They would, why do you say that? They will push you away. And if you keep pushing back, eventually you'll have a desk job and that'll be the end of it.
So what you're saying then are that they're disappearing these flights because they don't want people to understand the actual routes these planes are taking, correct?
Yes. Yeah. They could sit, and I was hoping they would try to fix it or try to fake it, but I, for whatever reason, there's not an elegant way to do that. And I'm not exactly sure why. Again, problem solver. I'd like to try to, I was trying to do it myself. I was going, it was the easier of the options. And that was, look, let's just not deal with it. And let's just kill everything below the equator. And again, over land, if it's over, South America, Australia, there's planes all over the place. And you're thinking, well, and then if you look in the Northern Hemisphere, they're flying all over the place, fine. Everything looks fine in the Northern Hemisphere. It's just those three oceans, the South Pacific, the South Atlantic, and the Indian Oceans.
Why?
Why those three? Because, you don't have to do the South Atlantic, but if you leave that one normal, then it's going to raise more eyebrows than if you don't. So the South Pacific, absolutely, you have to kill it if you can, because you don't want to show people. You don't want to show people because the planes aren't going that way. Is what I'm saying is on that map, the planes cannot go the South Pacific because the route is longer. The oceans get stretched on that map. So the plane, from a fuel consumption standpoint, can't take that route. Now, you can try to fake it if you want, but you're going to get caught sooner or later, which is probably what's happening now. Indian Ocean is not much is happening over there anyway. But the South Atlantic, lots of stuff happening, but you can't leave that one open, because if you do, then people will, you know, they'll say, okay, why is this working here but not working there? Then it looks like a technical issue. So it's like out of sight, out of mind. And I even had people come back and say, you know, could it be for even a weirder reason, which I didn't touch on in the clues, and I'm on the fence on that one, and that is it possible that they're not showing the routes because they can't show the routes because there's no coverage, but which touches on the whole satellite issue, which is, in an enclosed system, can you put something in a circular orbit? Maybe, maybe not. You can do stuff with spy planes. You can do stuff with repeating planes, but there would be gaps in the coverage. But a GPS system, by definition, has no gaps in the coverage. So then it gets even weirder than that. But several people have suggested that to me. I was going, yeah, that's very possible.
Well, that's very weird.
I know.
I mean, it's just like, it's above and beyond, really. It's the next level of conspiracy, isn't it? I mean, a couple of things come up, come into mind. MH17, which we're all familiar with, the plane that disappeared. I mean, I remember saying to my mate, I said, listen, pal, I don't even know if that plane took off. You know, there's so many lies out there. I've got no idea. All those people who are crying for lost relatives, they could be actors. I don't know. It's Hollywood. Yeah. So I don't know.
People mentioned that those flights to me several times, and my response was like, okay, at the very least, they weren't being tracked. Now that I know, they over the Indian Ocean, they weren't being tracked. But did they take off in the first place? You have no freaking idea. But yeah, that came to mind even before I was kind of dealing with this, which was, look, that's a 777, right? It's a flagship. You don't lose plane. We don't, it's 20, whatever year, was that last year or the year before? 2013, 2014? Doesn't really matter. The point is, we don't lose planes. You don't lose them. So, yeah, I didn't know what to believe down there, but I absolutely knew it wasn't being tracked, at the very least.
So, and of course, when I was a kid and taking a year off, we could get around the world ticket, you know, from one country to the next. The very concept of round the world would suggest that we're going round the world. But you're suggesting, rather than going like that, we're going like that.
Yeah, you can still go around the world. Yeah, and that has become the new argument. And that is, oh yeah, well, this guy sailed around the world, and this guy sailed around the world. I'm going, well, yeah, but if you're in a really big area, you can do a circle. It's kind of like the old joke. What is it? If you're walking in the desert, make sure you don't have a leg injury, because you will naturally start to walk in a wide arcing circle. Same sort of thing with boats. You know, there's lots of stories about them having to correct course all the time in the old days. And sailing around the world now, yeah, you can do it, but you're not. I mean, technically, yeah, you're still sailing around the world. You're just not going around a globe.
So what's the future then? If is this going to become, because clearly there was a time when we all thought we lived on a flat earth. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Now I know you've brought up, some of the videos I've watched have shown the United Nations flag. Is that correct?
Yeah. The United Nations flag, which was designed in 1946, which is interesting because that was before everything went nuts in 1956, which meant that they knew and they were kind of getting ahead of themselves, in my opinion. But the United Nations flag is an exact replica, with one omission, of the flat earth map, of the azimuthal equidistant map. You lay them right on top of each other, and it shows all the continents laid out on a flat surface with these giant wreaths around them. What's interesting, though, is Antarctica isn't on that map. And Antarctica had been discovered a long time before that, and it's a massive continent, so why isn't it on that map? Why did you replace it with this giant wreath of spiky, you know, things that go around the outside of it? And they don't address it. You can look it up. They don't tie it. Because they put these circles on the inside of the UN flag. It's like, is it implied on the outer circle? No. They don't talk about it. It's really, really interesting. The UN flag, it's you know, some people say, well, it's in your face. I was going, yeah, it's in your face. But even I think they jumped the gun, because I think 8 years later, they still hadn't found it in 1954. And then, of course, Murphy's Law, you know, 1956, they do.
So what's the future? Because clearly there's so many conspiracy theories, Planet X, Nibiru, the Anunnaki, and it goes on. So in your opinion, are there aliens as an example?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, most other conspiracies don't get canceled out by this thing, which is great. The first one, most notably, Hollow Earth. People say, well, are you dismissing Hollow Earth? No, not at all. Hollow Earth could very well exist, and not coincidence that Admiral Byrd, mostly known for the Hollow Earth thing, supposedly found it in 1926, then he turns around and goes the other way. Aliens, absolutely, I believe in them. I watch them here in Colorado with night vision binoculars. The skies are crawling with stuff. Most of the stuff you can't see with your naked eye, I highly recommend night vision binoculars. But in an enclosed system, they become way more interesting, in my opinion, because, okay, are they part of the superintendent system? Are they part of the maintenance team? Are they janitors? We don't know. Or are they stuck in here with us? That's the other thing. You know, it's like, can they get through whatever, you know, is there a barrier they can't get through, or can they move freely from one to the other? Either way, I absolutely believe in them. 100%. Planet X takes a whole other context. And that is, for me now, because I was a Planet X follower, absolutely, you know, but now it's 2015. It's like, okay, we're, you know, people keep bringing it up. It's like every 2 months, it's like, it's coming. It's like, well, yeah, it may come now, but if it does, it is probably going to be the biggest staged event of all time, if that's the case, because in an enclosed system, it's not real. Now, you could do some wonderful things, you know, throw in Project Bluebeam, throw in some meteors or simulate meteors or whatever you want. You could do some really, really neat stuff. But for me, if it shows up in the sky, I'll be going, how are they doing that? You know, I'll be looking at it completely differently than I would have before. Beforehand, I was like, you know, like the movie Melancholia. It's like, you know, run away. But everything else dovetails in pretty well, with the exception of people that say that they've been to, you know, Venus or Mars or that stuff, you know, and you know, they could have been deceived, you know, could have been tricked. There was a guy that said he took a portal to Mars, and it's like, well, yeah, maybe, or maybe they just took you to a place and said it was Mars. So,
but of course, there are many people on the planet that say that there are portals on the planet in various parts, Egypt, blah, 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 you know.
Yeah. Where those portals go, where they lead, it changes in this model, because they could be leading just outside to a different space. But for me, most conspiracies remain intact, but everything becomes much more intimate, which is great. You know, I try to tell people, it's like, are you trying to kill astrology? I'm going, No, I mean, you know, it's still a beautiful clock system up there. It just doesn't have to be millions of light years away. You know, the sun and the moon are your sun and the moon. It's nobody else's. Everything becomes much more intimate. And I know we didn't really touch on it, but the message, the reason why I think this should be revealed, and maybe it's why it's being talked about now, is that I think it still could turn humanity into a better version of itself. Because once you know that you've got regardless whether you see them or not, you've got a hidden parent that's looking over your shoulder, do you still do all the bad things you used to do? Yeah, maybe, but it didn't look like it. You know, when I did Clue 11, when I saw the astronauts that wouldn't lie, why did that happen? You know,
okay, talk to me about Clue 11, the astronauts that wouldn't lie.
Clue 11, Souls in the System. There was another thing that bugged me about a documentary that was made some years ago called Astronauts Gone Wild, where I can't remember his name, but I should remember it. I'm not doing him justice. But he was an irritating interviewer that would go around, and he was trying to trip up the astronauts, the Apollo astronauts, by, you know, hitting them with different details. But he caught this little hook, which was he took a Bible with him, and he tried to make them swear on it. It was just like a simple little thing, right? It's like, hey, you know, put your hand on this and swear that you went to the moon. And they reacted to that thing like it was radioactive. And I was going, and that bugged me, because I was going, why would they care? It's like, it's not, they're not in court. They're not going to get in trouble. Hell, are any of them, you know, are they all Christian? You know, because that was, it was a Christian Bible. It didn't make sense. And then when I was looking at this thing, I was going, oh, I see what happens here. Because those astronauts, which I firmly believe they were let in on it at one point, you know, which is why they got so depressed and crawled into bottles and hid from people. I think they were told, okay, different from the astronauts now, where they say, okay, you're faking it, but we're not going to tell you why because of a clearance issue. With those guys, though, because it was the first run, it was like, okay, you're faking it, here's why. And here's the photographs. After so many years, that sunk in to where that started to rattle around in their head. And they're going, okay, if there is a divine power, and I'm not going to name what divine power it is. If there is divine power, then you may be accountable for your actions. May not, but may. But for those guys, you know, Boy Scout heroes type stuff, you really going to roll those dice? You're going to take the chance? No way. No way. They weren't gonna do it. So if somebody walks up to them, probably the first time in their life, and says, swear on this, and people gave me crap. They said, you know, it didn't have to be a Bible. It could have been something else. You know, I said it could have been a chunk of wood. It made no difference because it's not the Bible that they were swearing on. It was their impression of where we are. And I tried to use the Santa Claus reference. And it's like, look, for those people that don't get what I'm saying, the naughty and nice list for Santa Claus doesn't make really much difference unless you see Santa Claus in your living room eating cookies. Then it takes on a whole nother meaning. And it's like, ah, crap, it's real. Are you going to do anything naughty anymore? Pfft, no. So apply that to everyone all at the same time. You know, if this does get revealed, and I'm going to do my damnedest to see that this thing moves forward one way or the other, this thing's getting proven out. If that happens, we change. It changes. I believe that wars end, hate crimes end, racism gets knocked down a whole bunch of pegs, sexism gets knocked down a whole bunch of pegs. People, and again, people say, well, you know, some people say, well, it's an overlordy thing. You know, we shouldn't have people, you know, we shouldn't have a divine power looking over our shoulder. I'm just going, really? Because when you run a red light, that's one thing. But why don't you run a red light if there's a camera there? Why don't you do it? And it's like, well, because we'll get caught. I'm just going, then why were you thinking about running the red light? Don't be better. That's where I'm going with this.
Ultimate big brother. So when I can see the Mediterranean out my window, okay? And it's a pretty flat line that I can see in the distance. Straight, flat line. But there's a kind of curvature, and it curves around me, right? Which suggests that we're on a... To me, suggests that we're on a round planet.
Take a picture, because people bring that up all the time. And if anyone has doubt, because I cannot tell you the amount of videos that people go out there and they'll go to the beach. Love watching these, where people go out to the beach with their cam, you know, their phone, and it's like, look, you know, and they say it. It's because it's in your head. They say, look, I can see the curve. I can see the curve. Take a picture of it. Put it on your monitor. Grab, it doesn't have to be a ruler, it could be just a piece of paper, put it up to it, tell me if that curve's there. We want to see I want to see the curve. I do, I wanted it, I want it, and that's the part that's going to make this, right now, I mean, it is the most polarizing thing I've ever seen in my life. You know, there's other polarizing topics out there, but this one, because it's in your head already, there's so many people, it's like, I cannot begin to tell you, they said, I've seen the curve, and yet, I have yet to see something that shows definitively out there. And we've been looking, you know, we've been looking now. It's been since February, since this thing's really exploded. We've been looking for the curves, and we haven't found them. So
I said the same thing to my friend over lunch today. And he said, he just come back, my mate and his daughter just come back from Cuba. And he said, no, listen, I was flying at 30,000 feet. And I can see the curve up there. Next time you're on a plane, have a look.
I did business travel for 7-8 years, flew all over the place, and at every altitude you can think of, every plane model, everything, and the windows. I'm not saying it's a conspiracy, not at all. The double pane windows they use on planes, do not give the best indicator of, unless you're looking exactly straight out, exactly in the center of it, you may see a curve again, but take a picture. That's why I got to just keep telling people. It's like, look, I know what you think you see, but you also got to remember that, you know, there's all sorts of things that people tell you, told you over the years that you don't, you know, for God's sakes, doctors told endorse cigarettes for years over, at least over here in the States. And then later we find out, you know, of what they're about. I know this is much, much bigger than that. This isn't, you know, it's apples and oranges, but if you're ever in doubt, take a picture, put it on your monitor, show the curve. And if you can find a curve, if you can find a definitive curve, put it online, but put it anywhere online, because the internet will find it. And, you know, we can shut this thing down in 2 seconds. For me, my test, the one I'm hoping to gun for eventually, is going to be a little more elaborate than that. And that is trying to prove out the Antarctic coastline. For me, that's the way to do it. And that is, because you're never going to get into Antarctica. Forget about that noise. People say, oh, we're going to charge the ice. We're going to charge the ice. The easiest way to prove this thing out, for sure, for absolute, because people can do curvature tests all day long. And I know that's what people want to do. But if you want to prove this thing out, you take two boats or one boat and one plane. You put them within visual distance of the Antarctic coastline so you don't freak out anybody with the treaties. One goes clockwise. The other goes counterclockwise. And if it's only about the same distance around as, say, Australia, then they should meet up in roughly a week if you're using two boats, right? But the discrepancy between that map, what we have now as a map, and the flat map is monstrous. That outer edge should be huge, in which case you could go for almost a month with those two boats and they would never run into each other. And of course you never want to go an entire month, because you know you could quit after 2 weeks if you wanted to. Or you could do one boat and one plane. You wouldn't even have to use any ship fuel. Take one boat, just leave them in the same spot and have the plane go. 13, 14 hours later, should be able to come back around to that same boat. Should be an easy way to prove it, one way or the other. Again, it's not super cheap, but it, for me, that's the only way to know for sure, other than NASA coming forward, you know, maybe.
It's a hell of a challenge, though, isn't it? Because there's got to be some billionaire out there who could fund that kind of activity if someone is inquisitive enough to find out.
It wouldn't cost that much. Relatively.
100 grand, maybe more.
Yeah, maybe it's just some jet fuel. You'd need a plane that could do 14 hours straight. I know there's some smaller long-range private jets that can do it. And again, the boat doesn't have to do anything. Boat can just sit there and not do a damn thing and just make sure it has radio communication and make sure the plane the key here is the plane cannot follow GPS, because the GPS system, which was designed by the United States military and went online in 1995, was the secondary part of this. It was a great stopgap solution, because not only does it tell you where you are, but it'll kind of point you where they want you to go if you're not in the right place. Now, going from here to the store, that means nothing. But if you're in Antarctica or somewhere, you know, where you shouldn't be, they can feed you any amount of coordinates you want. Why? And you're going to believe it. Why wouldn't you? So
that in theory would be find a spot quite close to Antarctica, and just follow as if you're following a fence all the way around until you get back to your same spot.
Yeah, there's been stories, and again, they're really conflicting. There's been stories of older explorers, and not that much older, we're not talking ancient times, that tried to circle this thing and took forever, and they never could find the edge, you know, the same edge as they went around. And then there's people that said, oh yeah, well, you know, a Russian military thing did it, you know, in so many days. And it's like, okay, which one do you believe? Because you don't know until you do it yourself, you're not going to know. But there hasn't been any independent group that has done this yet, because let's face it, the topic's too new. Again, if you would have come to me spring of last year and mentioned this topic to me, I would have laughed you out of the room. Absolutely. And I've know every conspiracy there is, you know, not chapter and verse, but I know them all. And I still would have laughed you out of the room. And now, for whatever reason, you know, maybe again, maybe something is coming in the fall and this is part of it. I'd hate to think so, because that would be horrible. But It is the topic, and it's been floating around in the conspiracy world. I don't know why. I'm glad to be a part of it.
Yeah, it's a hot topic. It's an absolutely hot topic. I jumped on this topic from Sophia's about 2 or 3 days ago, and bang, here we are talking about it. Just blew my mind.
I'll throw one more at you. Here's the weird thing for me. It's not that we're talking about it. It's that I'm being allowed to talk about it.
What I was going to ask you. You know, would someone allow you to do that test around the perimeter of this flat Earth?
At this point, I don't know. I mean, initially I'm thinking, I joke with people. It's like, no, you'd be drone striked, or you'd sabotage the boats or something. You know, you wouldn't want to let me. But everybody that I've done interviews with, they all say the same thing. They almost verbatim. It's like, I can't believe we're talking about this. It's, you know, it's come out of nowhere, and everybody's kind of feeding on it to where I don't think it's, they're talking about it just because other people are talking about it. They're talking about it because it seems to be getting some sort of, we've moved past, I can't believe we're saying this. We've moved past the ridiculous stage to the debatable stage. To where beforehand people would just wave you off. I wasn't kidding in the first video when I said there were people that would come up to me, you know, literally and say, look, there's reptilians in Parliament, right? And I go, let me tell you about flat Earth. And they'd be like, get out of here. You know, they wouldn't want to talk to me. But those same people now are looking at this and saying, this is actually a real topic to talk about. And so, yeah, where's it going to go? I don't know. I mean, it's there's more and more people putting out to where I have to go on YouTube and I have to set the filter to today. I just type in flat Earth. I set it to today. And there's just wave after wave of people that are just putting stuff. There's stuff out being put out now that's better production value than mine that people are putting out. It's like, holy crap. And they're finding little angles. I think it's like, maybe it's like that gold rush thing where everybody's trying to figure out if there's a little niche that nobody's found yet. You know, the little, you know, everyone's looking for the smoking gun because now that it's a real topic, everybody's looking for, okay, you know, is NASA going to trip up here? Is Illuminati going to trip up here? Who's going to make the mistake and are we going to find it? Because if somebody finds, you know, something more, even more concrete, it's going to be wild.
Well, I think you should put that out there that we're looking, or not we, but the movement is looking for a financier to fund that idea. You know, that'd be a great idea.
I have been putting feelers out, and if I have to go down there and be on the plane or be on the boats or whatever,
wouldn't you?
I'd have to. Because I couldn't trust. I mean, there's a few people I could trust, but I couldn't trust, you know, an independent group going on their own. God help. The what?
You'd have to do it.
I know. I would. I wouldn't mind. I wouldn't like going on the ice very much, you know, if it was Antarctica based, but I wouldn't mind going doing the boat thing.
That'd be great. It'd be great. But wouldn't you want to be in the plane?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'd do the plane too.
Yeah.
Yeah, even though the entire time during the plane, I wouldn't even worry about it. It's like, okay, they're either going to hit us or they're not going to hit us. So, you know, and of course, then you read, you know, tragedy, flat earther.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Committed suicide. Apparently, you jumped from a very tall building with a banker. Because they're jumping at the moment, like, yeah, it's not a very nice topic, but they're jumping left, right, and center. Okay, yeah. So Mark, let's that's great, you've blown my mind. If you could just tell people how they could get in contact with you, that'd be great.
Right now, I'm not a big social media guy, so I'm not on Facebook, not on Twitter. In fact, I had to take a crash course in programming, front-end JavaScript, just so I could get my website up. So the website is called enclosedworld.com. And if you can't remember that, all you have to do is either Google Flat Earth Clues or Google Enclosed World. It should come up pretty quick.
Hey, I'm Herschel, Herschel 36. Thanks for listening to Truth is Stranger Than Fiction on the Beat. Hope you enjoyed the interview. If so, give Truth a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe. Sponsored sponsored by Just Finish It Records. Hope for the best, prepare for the worst.